گزارشگر ویژه شورای حقوق بشر سازمان ملل برای ایران اخیراً در اولین گزارشش به مجمع عمومی سازمان ملل به موارد زیاد نقض حقوق بشری در ایران اشاره کرده است. از شکنجه و آزار زندانیان سیاسی و مرگ در حین بازداشت شماری از آنها گرفته تا نقض آزادی بیان و صدور حکم اعدام برای افراد زیر سن قانونی. تکرار گزارش‌های گذشته. آیا گزارشگران ویژه برای ایران تا به حال تأثیری برای بهبود حقوق بشری در ایران داشتند؟ جاوید رحمان ششمین گزارشگر ویژه سازمان ملل برای بررسی وضعیت حقوق بشری در ایران است. حدود 4 ماه قبل به این سمت منصوب شد. او استاد و رئیس پیشین دانشکده حقوق دانشگاه برونل در بریتانیا است و یکی از پرکارترین پژوهشگران در زمینه حقوق و اسلام است و ده‌ها کتاب و صدها مقاله در این خصوص منتشر کرده است. کتاب 1000 صفحه‌ای او زیر عنوان حقوق بین‌المللی بشری در دانشگاه‌ها تدریس می‌شود. تسلط او بر حقوق و به خصوص حقوق در قوانین اسلام تا چه حد می‌تواند عاملی برای موفقیت او در مأموریتش باشد؟ Professor Javed Rahman, welcome to the program.
Thank you.
Shortly after appointed as a special rapporteur for Iran, you said that I'm looking forward to a constructive engagement with the Iranian authorities and hope to create a space for informed and open dialogue with the authorities. Nearly 4 months later, where are we now?
Well, I said that at the beginning of the mandate, as you correctly pointed out, and I have had engagement. I met the Iranian ambassador in Geneva, and I also had the great honor and pleasure to meet the ambassador in New York. And in between, I have had various forms of communications, various forms of engagement, and I think it's a beginning of a process.
Yes. You recently presented your first report to the General Assembly of the United Nations. Can you tell me the main points, the main areas that you are most concerned about in terms of human rights in Iran?
Well, there are a number of areas where there is concern. In my UN General Assembly report, I highlighted the key aspects. So one of the key concerns that I have is the continuing execution of juvenile offenders, by which we mean people who are charged and arrested when they are below the age of 18. And I'm very saddened and sorry to note here that 5 of these juvenile offenders were executed just this year, despite concerns from the United Nations and from other international bodies. In addition, there are several other features. So I mentioned the continued persecution of religious and ethnic minorities. I'm concerned at the failure or the limitations of due process and the violation of criminal justice system, confessions through torture, arbitrary arrests, you know, in lack of independence of judiciary. But then there are several others, you know, freedom of expression, you know, the freedom of religion or belief. Rights of women being violated. So there's a whole catalogue of rights that are undermined.
Right. Since you haven't been to Iran to gather your information, so how did you gather all this information? How are you sure that you have the right information about these violations?
Yeah, well, as you rightly say, access has not been allowed, and despite my various suggestions and insistence. So in the absence of access, what we have is we can have access by other means. So I have been engaged with consistent individual testimonies. I have been talking to the relevant families, victims' families, but I have also had a very close look at a huge amount of documentation that's been presented. So, notwithstanding the limitations that I have of not direct access to Iran, it does not prevent me from having access. So there are various technological means that we can now use to see what is happening, including, you know, Skype and phone and other mechanisms.
Since you've presented your report to the General Assembly, have you had any response from Iranians?
Since my response to the General Assembly, there was a dialogue within the General Assembly, but there has been no official response from the
right. Iranians. In the past, Iranians have responded to your predecessors' reports by branding them as being in the pockets of the enemies of Iran, by not gathering a proper factual information, by saying that most of the elements of the reports that you produced are baseless because they were gathered from the people who are hostile to Iranians. So you didn't have that kind of response so far. Do you see them as a good sign that they may be cooperating a bit more compared to your predecessors?
I am not sure whether not criticizing the substance of the report means that they will cooperate, because what I understand and what I felt from a response from the Iranians from my report was that there was nothing critical about the content or the substance of the report. There was a lot of allegations about the politicization of the mandate, just as it was in the case of my predecessors. So I think I would welcome some substantive discussion, including if the Iranians challenge my findings. They should allow me access to the country, and that access should be more transparent so that I can have a better information of fact-finding.
Mm-hmm. How the infringements of the freedom of expression, you mentioned that, but how it is featured in your report? As you know, in recent times, there have been a number of people who have been defenders of the freedom of expressions, many of them political activists, many journalists. They have been sentenced to a very long prison sentences. So how these issues, which seems to be very topical at the moment, features in your reports and future investigation.
Yes, yeah. I mean, this is an issue of serious concern, because as you know, from the protests which started December last year, and there are continuing waves of these protests, these human rights defenders, these journalists, the people who defend others, have been a consistent target of victimization, harassment, arrests. And in my report, I mentioned a few by name of these human rights defenders who have unfortunately been incarcerated or put on arbitrary arrests. So there is a very concerning feature that emerges from the time, certainly, that I took over as mandate holder.
Mm-hmm. You know, the persecution of journalists is not limited to the media workers inside Iran. Many of the media workers outside Iran who are working for the broadcasters outside Iran have been harassed. Their families have been harassed. You know that in the case of BBC journalists, over 150 of them have been targeted. And accused of all sorts of things. And also their assets, whatever they had, have been practically frozen in Iran, and the persecution of them and their families are still going on. So what are you going to do about this, basically?
Well, it's a very disturbing feature, and BBC Persian has been targeted, victimized. And it's not just the individuals, but as you say, it's their families, and it's the people who they know. And the victimization, the harassment, the freezing of assets is highly unfortunate, because it sets a very tragic and unfortunate precedent for other, media workers or journalists or, you know, media houses. So I'm very concerned about it. It's going to feature. I have made a reference to it in my report already. I know that my predecessor, Asma Jahangir, was very concerned, and I am very determined to have this issue right at the forefront of my consideration.
I know that your report, basically you just follow up your predecessor's work and also new cases and all that. I mean, when you compare your recent report, your findings basically compared to the previous reports, to Ahmad Shahid's reports and then later Asma Jahangir's report, how do they compare? Is there any improvement or any deterioration of the human rights case in Iran?
Well, there have been situations which have improved. So, for example, the anti-narcotics drug law has been a positive development, which has resulted in significant reduction in executions. And my predecessors had noted while this law was in process, and Asma did reference this issue in her report. And I think that there have been phases where some aspects have been noted as positive. So anti-drug law, the citizens' charter, or aspects of women's rights, for example, there have been positive developments. So my predecessors have very rightly regarded that as positive developments. But that said, there are also very serious concerns. And there are some trends which have been ongoing. So for example, when I mention about rights of religious minorities or ethnic minorities being undermined, the issue of human rights defenders, the issues of due process, the problems in the criminal justice system. I think that there's a continuing trend, and unfortunately, in many of these areas, there is a sort of a deterioration or a negative trend, and which is very disturbing for me.
Mm-hmm. Professor Rahman, you're the sixth special rapporteur for Iran. Which since 1984, where Mr. Andres Aguilera was appointed. As you know, he resigned after 2 years because he didn't see any cooperation with the Iranians. And then apart from Mr. Galen Dupont, who was allowed to Iran, who had three trips to Iran, and after that he was banned from traveling, apart from him, none of the other special rapporteurs have been allowed to Iran. Do you think that you might be the exception?
Well, I hope so, and I'm committed to do that. I'm just hopeful that the Iranian government recognizes the value of the UN special rapporteur. And instead of just labeling my predecessors as being politicized or having different agendas, they look at the achievements and they look at the positives which the role of the UN Special Rapporteur has brought. And I think Access would obviously support them as well, because I could be more objective. I could be talking to the very people, and I could also be talking to the officials. So I think it's in their interest that they allow me that free, unhindered access.
Have you seen any indication that they might be considering it?
Well, in the short time that I have interacted with them, no, there's been no clear indication. Unfortunately, as you said, the record of my predecessors does not give a very positive indication. And one thing I'm quite clear about, that I will not be discouraged, or I could not be prevented from being critical and in terms of human rights violations. So I am a very committed person. So just by preventing access to Iran will not stop me from doing my work, which the UN has mandated me to do.
Mm-hmm. I recently interviewed your colleague Idris Jazairi, who is a special rapporteur investigating the negative effect of the sanctions on human rights of people. He said that he had been invited by the Iranians, but he said that he wanted to coordinate his trip to Iran with you. Do you think that since they are willing and actually invited Mr. Jazairi, they might be considering his request to you to accompany him?
Mr. Al-Jazairi is a colleague, and we work together. And there are a number of UN protocols. So I support what Mr. Al-Jazeri said about coordination in terms of access to Iran. The Iranians will, and as you say, may have invited him because it's in the interest of Iran, because they want to focus probably exclusively on the issue of sanctions. In terms of my mandate, there is an impact clearly when economic sanctions have negative consequences on human rights issues. But that's not the exclusive mandate that I have. I look into the human rights situation as a whole in Iran. So I'm not sure how the Iranians perceive my approach and my focus on human rights issues, which they are not approving. So for example, when I look at civil and political rights violations, I think that they may well be interconnected to economic, social and cultural rights, but denial of civil and political rights is not necessarily connected to sanctions. So I'm not entirely convinced that they will invite me, especially having regard to my predecessor's record.
Mm-hmm. So if they didn't let you go to Iran, you know that they're going to be criticizing you that your report is unrealistic, basically, because you haven't been to prison, you haven't seen the condition in prisons, you haven't talked to the victims and the relatives of the victims. So your reports, again, is not going to be a realistic report.
I think from what I've seen so far, the Iranians have not challenged me on the substance of the report. And I have a feeling that the Iranians are aware that there are so many mechanisms of having access. Obviously, it's their prerogative not to allow me that access. I would like to have access. I have requested it so many times. But I would also like an access where I would be unhindered to do the work that I'm there for. So I cannot prevent the criticism that comes from the Iranian government or from various Iranian quarters. But nevertheless, I'm quite committed to do my mandate in accordance with the code of conduct in terms of having and working closely with the individuals that are being affected or undermined or their rights being violated. So I will do the best job that I can do in the circumstances that I find myself.
So if they let you in, what would be your plan? Where would you be visiting? Who will you be visiting?
Well, if they let me in, it would be important for me to have an access which allows me to talk to individuals without their being afraid or fear of repercussions for them. I mentioned a list of issues where I have concerns. So criminal justice processes, the lack of rule of law, the issues that take place in places of detention, victims' rights being undermined. So all these would have to be analyzed when I visit Iran. So it is quite a lengthy set of access that I would want.
Yeah. The situation in prison is recently there have been lots of reports of being bad. Some of the prisoners, especially the political prisoners, have gone on hunger strike. And some have needed the medical attention, which they've been denied. So I'm sure you're aware of this, and you mentioned in your report as well. But these are the areas it's just not easy to find the exact facts about what's basically happening, unless you are inside the prison. Or you visit the prison. Mm-hmm. So how are you going to conduct an investigation in that area?
Well, if I'm allowed access, I'm already getting information from various sources, from indirect sources or families or victims, etc. But if I'm allowed access, I know where I need to go. Certain prisons, meeting and having access to certain prisoners, political prisoners, the way they're detained, I can have a first-hand experience, which is difficult. I admit, being remotely with my presence not being there, so I have a fairly good idea of what I want to do, which places of detention I want to visit, which people I need to speak to. It's more a question of how I'm given that access, how I'm allowed that access. And it is important that my report to be authoritative and objective and substantive. I must have that access, because otherwise it will be very difficult for me to have a conclusive position on what is going on the ground.
Mm-hmm. In the past, the Iranians justified basically their, even the torture and the executions on the Islamic law. I'm sure you're aware of the terms ta'zir, which basically justification for torture, and also the mufsid fil arz, which basically means corrupt on earth, which is Islamic terminology that they use to execute people. So do you think they are still basing their work, their executions and torture on the Islamic law, and how really realistic it is it with the Islamic law? I mean, is it Islamic, really?
It's an important question. I think we have to look at compatibilities between Islamic law and international human rights law. If you look at the global state practices, there are many countries which follow Islamic law, but they do not deviate from the principles of international human rights law. So looking at the core human rights treaties to which some of which Iran is a party, such as the International Covenant on Civil and Political Rights and the Child Rights Convention, for example, Iran has committed itself to follow those principles. So within the ICCPR, international covenants, there is a commitment to fair trial, there's a commitment to due process, there's a commitment to right to freedom of religion or belief, there's a commitment to freedom of expression. And most of the countries which follow Islamic law do not find an incompatibility. They are obliged to follow international human rights law. So I find it very a very bizarre, very awkward argument when the Iranians say just because their interpretation of Islamic law justifies torture or execution, they would implement it. And it is, in one form, a use of harassment of political opponents, unfortunately. It, in my understanding of Islamic law, that is neither Islamic, neither law.
There are many, as you said, many Muslim countries that they adhere to the civil codes in terms of criminal law or punishments or whatever. So how do they justify? I mean, are they deviating from the Islamic law or by adopting these civil codes?
I don't think so. I think if you look at, for example, the international consensus on the prohibition or condemnation of torture, all the countries in the world, including Muslim jurisdictions, they comply with the regulations that are set up by the Committee on the Rights of the Convention on the Rights on the Prohibition of Torture, the Torture Convention Committee, and various other conventions, including the International Convention on Civil and Political Rights, to which they're parties. And the ban on torture, as an example, has become what we call it as the norm of jus cogens. So you cannot actually deviate from it. And what is happening within these Muslim jurisdictions is that these countries comply with the ban on torture with the full conviction that Islamic law is fully complied with that. So there is no difference between Islamic law and international human rights law, to the extent that they follow international human rights principles.
I mean, this is coming from somebody who's done a huge amount of work on the Islamic law and all that. So I'm sure they take notice of your vast knowledge on that. But generally, human rights organizations, the special rapporteurs from the United Nations, they've been doing their job for many, many years, especially on Iran. And every year you are facing the same report, basically, more or less. Here and there, there must be a little bit of improvement. And as you said, on the other area, it's deteriorations. So nothing is basically happening. Are you, as a reporter, really effective in improving human rights?
I think so. I think despite the various hurdles and criticism, if you look at the progression, certainly from 2011, from the period of Dr. Ahmed Shaheed and then from Asma Jahangir, I think we have made a significant amount of positive contributions. So there have been some laws, which I mentioned, the drug law, for example. The right to life, you know, in many ways is the most important right. And we see with the implementation of that law, there is a dramatic reduction in executions, which we, you know, which we support and we welcome. There are other areas of concern, which I mentioned, where I think Iran must act immediately, and this will be my focus in the next report. So, as I mentioned, the continuing execution of juvenile offenders is a huge concern, and I think the Iranian government must take immediate action to stop all forms of execution of children. So, if that step is taken, and if children are no longer executed, I hope that next year this time we will be saying, well, this is a very positive step that's taken in the right direction.
Professor Rahman, as I said, you've been the most prolific in terms of judging by the amount of your publications on the human rights issues and human rights and Islam issues especially. Also, you have a very extensive experience in human rights activities as well. So, I mean, coming from that kind of position, you cannot be considered as a purely a dreamer. So, realistically, how optimistic are you that at the end of your mission, we will be facing Iran with a better standard of human rights?
I'm very optimistic, and I'm grateful for your comments. And I genuinely believe that change is possible. There have been movements. As I said, there are some positive developments. I think the problem remains about an ideological issue that Iran faces. If they can come up with overcoming that ideological issue, those hurdles that they face, that there are, and in that respect, my work as an Islamic law scholar, trying to have a comparative analysis of other Muslim states that they've had similar challenges of, you know, religious ideologies or, you know, cultural issues, etc., etc., to become a beacon of human rights. I think there is. I do not want to be overly optimistic, but there are real possibilities that Iran could develop its human rights commitment. So, for example, the Universal Periodic Review is a universal review, and Iran has, to its credit, been active in responding to various recommendations. So, I would urge Iran as a state to look at the recommendations that come from all the countries of the world and see whether and in what way they want to comply with it. And I think I'm hopeful that there is a will within the Iranian quarters, various stakeholders, and that over time, and certainly within my mandate, there will be some significant progress in terms of protecting the rights of individuals.
Mm-hmm. Do you think the Iranian will be willing to engage into ideological kind of discussions? I mean, with your background on Islamic law, your understanding and knowledge, do you think they engage with you on that respect rather than just technicality of the human rights violation?
I think they would engage, because again, it's very important to see, you know, what is the ideological basis which is preventing Iran from, let's say, giving equal rights to women or giving equal rights to religious or ethnic minorities. I think that this can be overcome. If you look at within the practice of Islam, there's huge amount of humanitarianism. There is huge amount of equality that we can see. So it's just a phase, you see. I mean, many countries have faced this ideological problem. These barriers are there, but they have overcome that. And I think that is the beauty of accepting universal human rights values, where all religions and all cultures come together. So what I would say is Iran, like other Muslim countries, should be contributing to human rights. They should be the leaders of human rights and not shrug away or shrink away from Human Rights saying, okay, it's against our ideological beliefs and values.
Thank you very much, Professor Javed Rahman.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Great pleasure. Thank you.